ड्रीम शो का डिलीवर हो रहा है ये चमत्कार है। अब तो बाहर मिस कर रहा हूं चमत्कार।
हाय लक्ष्मी,
so on one Good afternoon, all the participants. In the stroke series, we have completed clinical stroke syndromes, dealt with anterior circulation, learned about brainstem stroke syndromes, what the clinician should know in MRI, we completed. And today's class will be to familiarize the students and physicians and neurology students about vascular imaging that is required for their understanding of stroke and plan the management strategies depending on the findings, when to order DSA and whether DSA, CT angiography, MRA, which modality to follow, and how do you make a decision about intervention in acute stroke as well as in chronic stroke. When you have a problem of carotid stenosis, which particular modality would you prefer? Can you make your decision based on CT angiography, MRA, Doppler studies, or is it DSA? And after that, we'll make a brief discussion about stroke in other diseases. So the scheme of this presentation will be, we'll have a brief introduction and followed by a digital subtraction angiography in acute ischemic stroke and the intracranial stenosis, then carotid stenosis DSC. Then we discuss about magnetic resonance angiography MRA and time of flight sequences, contrast enhanced MRA, when do you order contrast enhanced studies, and what is the diagnostic accuracy of MRA. And then the most common modality nowadays ordered is CT angiography, and what is the diagnostic and therapeutic impact, and what information we can derive, collateral scores and the clot burden score, and can we diagnose carotid stenosis and order interventions, or does it have any limitations, and how to judge which is better, CT angiography or DSA, the decision making. And we'll end the talk with some DSA studies in other diseases causing stroke.
So there's a request that you should talk a little louder.
Yeah. So vascular imaging is invasive distal subtraction angiography and non-invasive carotid Doppler, MR angiography and CT angiography. So we will deal with DSA, MRA and CTA in particular. The world sees DSA or carotid angiography. That was way back in 1927, Egas Monage is first invented that. And it is a gold standard for selecting cases for carotid interventions. That's why all the stroke specialists are interested in knowing when to apply that. Both ECST and NASET trials used DSA for quantification of the stenosis and further interventions. The advent of CTA has changed this, which is a non-invasive method and it rivals DSA. But all the advances in reperfusion therapies, whether endovascular therapy or stenting or due to DSA. So CTA only guides the machine. If you familiarize with the DSA, you have an arterial phase, then a capillary phase and a venous phase. So there are various projections. This is not a class about what are the projections, and that's for you of the radiologist. We'll understand what we require as clinicians in DSA. What are the findings in DSA of ischemic stroke that are important to us, which we deal first? if at all you use in diagnosis of ischemic stroke, which is being done nowadays. Abrupt cutoff, if embolus is the meniscus sign, there is a bare area in capillary phase in acute ischemic stroke. So in 80% of acute ischemic stroke, early angiography demonstrates a large artery occlusion, either embolic or due to in situ thrombosis. You can estimate the clot burden or volume to plan revascularization approaches. So carotid angiography has become an integral part whenever you consider intra-arterial thrombolytic therapy, the blood clot aspiration and retrieval with mechanical devices, or your carotid stenting. So these are the, it's a part of that. So we should know what is happening after DSA. We also can assess the leptomeningeal collateral flow, that is from the external carotid artery to ophthalmic artery and then to internal carotid artery, the flow through the circle of Willis. So DSA facilitates the study of all these, and this is a diagram depicting ACA and MCA collaterals and PCA and MCA collaterals. More about this when we deal with CT angiography. And what is the role of DSA in acute ischemic stroke and intracranial stenosis? So we have already dealt with large artery identification in emergency. We discussed about NIHS stroke scale and VAN scale, where you suspect that a large artery is occluded. So then you do look at the infarct related artery and you may opt for MRA, CTA or DSA. Being the oldest, I am dealing with DSA first. Subsequently, we'll have a look at MRA, which is commonly ordered, or CTA in the next, in the last segment. The non-invasive modalities, they fail to detect intracranial stenosis. That is proven by Sonia trial and stroke outcome and neuroimaging of intracranial atherosclerosis study. Moreover, for the intracranial stenosis, the NASET method, which cannot be applied to calibration, cells are very small in caliber and they tend to taper distal to stenosis. So this leads to underestimation of stenosis, though there are some formulas. Only we can have a visual impression of the stenotic areas, especially in the basilar artery territory or the M1, M2 territories, which we are going to see. The posterior circulation stroke and a basilar artery territory, you see the areas which are the AP projection of the vertebral basilar artery, and occlusions are seen, and vertebral artery lateral projection, abrupt cutoff of the basilar artery or pacification. And after thrombolysis, it opens up and the entire basilar artery and PCA vasculature comes out. So to facilitate this, we require this. For this intervention, endovascular therapies are the order of the days, and all the residents who are dealing with stroke should know it's just not getting a CT scan done and identify the infarct and order some therapy. Should know the pathophysiology of the stroke, why it has happened in a particular individual. Is it only the vascular risk factors, or are there underlying pathologies you have to study? The vertebral artery projection, you see tandem stenotic lesions can cause stroke like this. So if we miss this, then the outcome is going to be very bad. Here the intracranial cutoff of M1 segment. So if this is a case, then maybe we have to rush up this case to endovascular person who can remove the clot and improve the outcome. So this is the importance of knowing large artery occlusions. So large artery occlusion detection starts in emergency room, where you employ the severity assessment scales, the VAN scale, which is vision, aphasia and neglect, that we have discussed. And also NIHS stroke scale, if it is more than 6 or 6 to 12, then it indicates large occlusion, then immediately you should plan. If you have a facility for endovascular, then DSA is the important thing. So you see the absence of MCA vasculature in this lateral projection of ICA, and left ICA injection, frontal projection, some opacification of ACA vasculature is seen, but occlusion of the tip of the ICA is seen. So this intravascular stenosis has to be identified in acute stroke. Whereas in chronic strokes, what we are interested is risk stratification. You do a Doppler study and you see that there is any carotid stenosis, which can we intervene that? Can we do a carotid stenting, or can we order, or can we request our colleagues to do a carotid endarterectomy? So that will facilitate the. Now some of these cases have to undergo the intervention within 14 days if there is a large artery occlusion and you diagnose a stenosis, you have to do a carotid endarterectomy within 14 days or 2 weeks after the onset of the stroke. So in that case, you see ICA stenosis just distal to bifurcation in this case, and after angioplasty, the stent placement. So the reperfusion is going to yield better functional outcomes. That is the crux. So you have to open the vessel that is stenosed or that is blocked, so that to facilitate a good functional outcome, a good MRS at the end of the 3 months. The Nasset measurements method, as you see, is shown here, and you can see the stenosed segment and the distal segment, and 1 minus A by pi into 100. So this is a percentage calculation. The question comes, can we apply this to CT angiography and communicate that this individual has 70%, 60% stenosis, because our knowledge is on Nasset measurements. So can we do it? So that's the question. Some clinicians with impunity, they go on saying that on CT angiography we diagnose 70%, 60%. Is it possible? This is a question which we are going to answer in subsequent sections. What are the complications of DSA? If DSA is gold standard, then why do MRA and CTA? That means the DSA is not totally without complications. It has some complications. There are non-neurological major complications or renal failure. And somebody is sharing the screen, I think. AV fistula or pseudo-aneurysm, 0.01 to 0.22%. Hematoma requiring transfusion is seen in 0.2 to 1.5%. The overall mortality and morbidity is 1 to 4%. In ECOS trial, half of the stroke risk was attributed to performance of carotid angiography. One more important point is, after DSA, even if there are no neurological symptoms developed, neuroimaging revealed minor infarcts, presumably secondary to embolism. That means DSA is associated with some complications, whether we are going to accept those complications and order DSA or resort to other modalities, we'll see. The MR angiography studies next. The MR angiography, what is the utility of time of flight images? What is the role of contrast enhanced MRA? And MRA performance for intracranial and extracranial stenosis. How can we interpret, how can we follow the results and order the interventions? Can we have faith or in our recommendations based on that?
So you have to just share screen again.
So this is what we are going to see. So we are going to learn about MRA, which is commonly done, and all the residents and everybody orders MRA. So how much importance we give to MRA findings? The TOF images are more suitable for intracranial vascular imaging. The sensitivity for diagnosis of intracranial stenosis with the MRA is comparable to CTA and DSA. So more, it's easily diagnosable. So whenever there is intracranial stenosis, MRA is sufficient for us. It is also used for screening and follow-up of several aneurysms, which the drawback of TOF MRA is overestimation of the degree of and length of stenosis. This is the major drawback with MR angiography, TOF image. And what if you do contrast MRE? There are fewer artifacts than TOF image. The cervical carotid and vertebral artery disease assessment is more accurate than TOF images. Atherosclerotic carotid artery lesions that are amenable for CEA can be more reliably differentiated. It also can identify the dissections, craniocervical arterial dissections. The arterial dissections are an important cause for stroke in young, especially in athletes and others. It can happen also in adults, but more commonly when you suspect stroke in young, we also look at the order for contrast enhanced MRE. A 49-year-old male, known diabetic, presented with a recurrent stroke in 1 month duration, first with the right hemiparesis, second right hemiparesis, Wernicke's aphasia on dual antiplatelets. So MRI has shown this findings here, which is there are occlusions and which can be seen on CT angio also. So that's the role. So what is the diagnostic accuracy of magnetic resonance angiography for internal carotid artery disease, both if the stenosis is very severe, very mild, or total occlusion? So I'll show you in the next slide the results of the whole study of this. They have studied and they found that about 140 patients, TOF MRI and contrast MRI showed high accuracy for detection of high-grade internal carotid artery stenosis. This is grade stenosis, 70 to 99% stenosis. The sensitivity of TOF and contrast enhanced MRI is good. The specificity is also good, that is 70 to 99%. And total occlusions also, the MRI is very good. But the problem comes in moderate stenosis. Here the sensitivity is less, 37 and 65 in contrast enhanced MRI. So what does it tell us? What does it tell us? That this it is overestimating the stenosis in some places and is not suitable for the moderate stenosis cases. Then we and its limitation stenosis on CTA. The CTA angiography has come in front of our eyes and we have learnt it. We are now using it very frequently and most of the centers have facility to do CT angiography, that multi-phase CT angiography and assessment of cerebral collaterals. The new science of cerebral collaterals is very important to understand the stroke outcome. So we'll see. So the most common infarct related imaging modality nowadays is CT angiography. A single bolus of iodinated contrast is enough. In few minutes time, axial source images and 3D images can be obtained. CTA can identify the quality of collateral circulation. The problem comes whether the iodinated contrast can be given whether before doing serum creatinine or not has been thoroughly studied, and it is said that you don't have to wait for serum. Colleagues don't agree to that, but they have to fall in line after some time at least, that here the time is essence and the neurons which are going to die are in millions. Even if there is mild contrast enhanced nephropathy, which may be dealt possibly, but the chances are very less. So CT angiography to be done in acute strokes on priority. It's a speedy technique. It's a study of the neck and head requires 5 minutes after application of iodinated contrast. The image acquisition is started when the contrast reaches arch of aorta or common carotid, whatever you ask for them to do. Just diagnose large vessel occlusions as in DSA in many instances. So now we'll see what are the studies that say that CTA is okay or you have to do DSA. The differentiation between near occlusion and complete occlusion is very, very much done by CTA, and it is a valuable tool in the diagnosis of an extracranial arterial dissections. It's also useful for spontaneous ICH in Eng and a spot sign for hematoma expansion, which we're not going to do or deal with ICH in this presentation. The quantification of collateral scores, which are seen in this diagram, can be done on CTA. The collateral scores will tell you how the patient is going to prognosticate. You can prognosticate the outcome of the patient. If there are good collaterals, the MRS score is going to be good. So it is a mass is a 5-point score, MTF is about 3-point score, MTAN is a 2-point score. So these scores can be applied to study collaterals and describe whether there are good collaterals or bad collaterals, which we can see in this. In addition to the collateral score, one more thing that we can do is a clot burden score. The blood clot, the thrombosis, the thrombus extent and location can be identified in CT angiography. So this is a new science which students should know that, yes, we can see the clot, we can see its extent, and we can study the CT angiography, and we can do a correlate it with even perfusion maps and source images. We'll show in the next slide. This is how the scoring is done. It is a 10-point one or 2 points are subtracted for absent contrast or pacification. So 10-point score is normal. As the score goes down, then the severity will increase. You see the infraclinoid, the supraclinoid, and proximal M1 segment, and distal M1 segment, M2 branches, and A1 segment, they all have been given numbers, scores. So if there is a clot C, then we minus. Like in this case, see, you see, this is a normal score, which we have shown. This is the normal score. This is a normal score, and there is no thrombus here. So all the points, if you add in the CT, it will be 10 points. If there is a thrombus in ICA, the score becomes 7. And if it is distal M1 and 2 M2 branches have, then the score becomes 6. And similarly, if there is occlusions in ACA territory and proximal M1, the score becomes 5. So clot burden score is an important knowledge which we develop. So we dealt with collaterals. You can see the intracranial stenosis. So diagnostic impact, within minutes, CTA reliably diagnosis arterial occlusion and stenosis from aortic arch to the distal intracranial arterial segments. Compared with MRI, CTA is sensitive for calcified blocks. It's a useful modality to study MCI occlusion if ipsilateral carotid is also stenosed. So CTA has got a very big diagnostic impact and a therapeutic impact. Patients with a small core of infarction on NCCT, that is a CTA source image, and an intracranial large vessel occlusion on CTA are ideal candidates for revascularization even beyond accepted time window. So it's an important derivation we do as far as therapeutics are concerned with CTA in acute stroke. If there is a small core of infarction, and which is, we call it, if it appears as a lacunar infarct, but once you do CTA, and you see an intracranial large vessel occlusion, then you can plan for endovascular therapy. So the lesson is that if you encounter a infarct which looks like a lacunar infarct or a small infarct, don't be satisfied there. It can be because of a proximal occlusion. So you have to by force study the infarct related artery, and you decide whether it is because of lipohyalinosis changes or small vessel vascular disease, or it's a large vessel occlusion. Unless you clarify your mind, you cannot go beyond progress anymore. You have to treat accordingly. So that's an important point which the students should keep in mind when they are dealing with. So now comes the carotid stenosis, which is the talking point when a stroke case comes, because you have dealt with intra-arterial thrombolytic therapy, endovascular therapy, then still the clot is removed. But still, if there is a stenosis, you have to identify, you have to subject them to carotid Doppler studies for a screening test, and then do MRA or CTA to establish that there is a stenosis and plan for interventions. So DSA is a gold standard, but complication rate varies from 0.5 to 5% of the stroke risk. Ultra-fast helical non-invasive CT imaging avoids this complication. So there is an excellent agreement between DSA and CTA. So CTA has the additional benefit of providing precise information regarding the surrounding vascular and bony anatomy, including the arterial wall calcification, that is not depicted by DSA or MRE. So there is a distinct advantage in this. In a previous prospective study of 40 patients with CTA, DSA and Doppler compared, the overall correlation was very good. The coefficient is 0.92. CTA provides superb correlation in the detection of mild stenosis of 0 to 29% and stenosis less than 50%. So sensitivity and specificity is more than 90% for mild stenosis. But it performed less well in detecting 70 to 99% stenosis. On axial source images, the sensitivity is 73%, positive predictive value is 0.62, negative predictive value is 0.95. So for the 70 to 99%, it is performing less well. There is poor discrimination between 50 to 69% and severe stenosis 70 to 99% by CTA. It's an important limiting factor for CTA. So we should understand that. We cannot base all the decisions on CTA only, because there are limitations. When the stenosis is between 50 to 69 or 70 to 99%, but it's an excellent thing with the mild stenosis 0 to 29 or less than 50%, the specificity and sensitivity in less degree stenosis is up to 90%. So for more, if you are encountering the stenosis of 50 to 99%, CTA has got poor discrimination, we may have to do DSA. That is the catch point. So whenever you see the pearl of string sign like this, you think that there is an occlusion, and you always do a CT angiography and a DSA, which is more clearly showing the stenotic segment here, and the than the CT angiography is also showing. But most of the surgeons prefer to have a DSA study than a CT angiography study. So stenosis can be calculated by NASET and ECST criteria. But you cannot do it as a 7, but you can extrapolate on axial images. That's how the quantification of carotid stenosis on CT angiography is done. And I'll show you the answer for this. Narrowest portion of ICA, internal carotid artery, beyond the bulb, where the walls are parallel, you select on axial image. NASET style ratios are calculated how? There is a linear relationship observed when derived percent stenosis. The percent stenosis derived is correlated with the millimeter diameter in 268 carotids. The correlation is 0.95. So if that diameter is 1.3 mm, it is 70% stenosis. If that diameter is 2.2 mm, it is 50% stenosis, which has got a high sensitivity, specificity and negative predictive value, as shown here, for defining a severe stenosis of 70% or higher. So now I have given you a method where the carotid stenosis can be estimated on CT angiography. The 67-year-old male, known hypertensive and diabetic, presented with history of right upper limb and lower limb weakness of a 1-day duration. And this is the MRI which is shown here. And you see the stenotic segment, both in the CT angiography and the DSA. And how do we calculate this is shown in the next few films. And you see the occlusions, acute right MCA infarction, which you can see here, conventional angiography, right ICA occlusion, CTS source images confirm the occlusions, and next. And you can see the occlusion here, and this has to be measured in the axial image. And how do you measure? The measurements are shown in this segment. This has to see the measurement has to be done like this, and this can, it is a 0.4 centimeters. You go back to the scale which I gave you and estimate the stenosis. So decision making for carotid interventions, whether carotid Doppler, MRA, CTA and DSA, are there any studies and what is the guideline for us, whether we can follow and give a correct decision. So this is a big study which has been done. Possible, it's not a big study, but study done to differentiate from operable and non-operable carotid artery lesions when ultrasound, the most and CTA and MRA are used. I'll show you the next slide. So what this study of 34 patients showed is all the three non-invasive modalities are compared with DSA. All three agreed with DSA in 80%, but CTA underestimated carotid stenosis, 65% sensitivity, 100% specificity. MRA overestimated carotid stenosis, sensitivity 100%, specificity 50%. Doppler, sensitivity 85% and specificity for 70%. So we have to give a decision now. Whenever an important person or any individual, when an important decision has to be taken, then all these things will come into mind. As long as every intervention goes without a risk, there is no problem. If the individual develops after procedure any risk, then all these things will come into play and you will be questioned. So the conclusion is Doppler, CTA and MRA all show similar accuracy in the diagnosis of symptomatic carotid stenosis. No technique on its own is superior enough to replace DSA, a big statement. If no two non-invasive techniques disagree, adding a third will lead to less than 6% of the diagnostic errors, but not entirely error free. No technique on its own appears accurate enough to replace DSA to determine the severity of carotid artery stenosis amenable for CEA. So the current guidelines, however, say that acute ischemic stroke recommend carotid ultrasound as a screening technique for imaging the pre-cerebral vasculature, whereas a confirmatory study is required with a second modality such as contrast, MRA or CTA. Still, there is gold standard is DSA, and CTA has its limitations. We cannot make any decision based on CTA, and there are a lot of institutions who are taking CTA as the primary modality to recommend carotid interventions to strongly and robustly recommend on CTA only. DSA and other causing diseases will be my final talk or final segment in this. So vasculitis is intracranial vasculitis is suspected, and multiple cerebral infarcts are detected in different vascular territories, and the only diagnostic modality at that in the intervention is the DSA, and it is could be autoimmune or because of infection. It's a gold standard, and if it is normal, it's more small vessels are not visible, so still there is a possibility you have to do biopsy. But if you encounter focal concentric narrowing, that is the most common in distal vasculature, you can increase your suspicion. DSA is a must to confirm diagnosis of vasculitis before starting immune suppressives, which have got their own problems because you have to give immunosuppressive therapy for a long time, more than a year or 2 years in certain cases. Then it is better to establish the diagnosis firmly. And fibromuscular dysplasias, arteriopathy of medium-sized arteries, 0.5 to 7%. It affects cervical and intracranial vasculature. Most of these lesions are C1 and C2. And DSA shows dilated and stenotic regions to give a string of beards along the tubular stenosis or tubular stenosis. So this is a 50-year-old male with behavioral issues of duration of 10 years, no vascular risk factors, presented with history of right hemiparesis 2 months back and required now had left hemiparesis. And this the MR findings, and we have lot of narrowing, distal narrowings in this Because DSA has to be studied laboriously, each vessel has to, each branch has to study for distal narrowings. In this case, we could identify and diagnose as a vasculitis case and treat him. So Takayasu's aortic arch injection, multiple large vessel tandem stenosis is seen in this case, and poor opacification of arch vessels secondary to stenosis of vessel origin is a stenosis of vessel origin, and poor opacification is Takayasu's arthritis. Moyamoya disease, the puff of smoke appearance, a cloud-like collateral network of vessels in Moyamoya, but there are multiple small channels. They are formed in response to chronic occlusive vasculopathy, which affects the large arteries at the base of the brain. And it could be idiopathic, or it could be secondary to radiation vasculopathy, Down syndrome. Intracranial ICA with thin multiple collateral vessels in the idiopathic variety. So that is seen in this ICA injection and lateral projection, absence of normal vasculature and puff of smoke appearance in Moyamoya disease. So cervicocephalic dissection, DSA is very important. As I said earlier, stroke in young, the DSA is to be considered whenever you think he is an athlete and you think of dissection because of trauma, fibromuscular dysplasias, and other vasculopathies. It manifests, dissection manifests as ischemic stroke, and less often as subarachnoid hemorrhage. Best diagnosed with axial MR IT1 image, but DSA tapering or narrowing of the vessel, the string or even total occlusion or a flap is seen. This is a dissecting and aneurysm, which is shown in this. So vertebral artery, lateral project, dissecting vertebral vascular aneurysm, you see the tapering and an aneurysm. So conclude by saying that angiographic advances have completely changed the management of stroke. In acute stroke, CTA rivals DSA. Both non-invasive and invasive modalities are accurate, but DSA is gold standard, as CTA underestimates and MRA overestimates the stenosis. Both are good modalities to study the intracranial stenosis, CTA and MRA. For vasculitis and dissections, DSA is a must. So ICH DSA indications are many, and I'm not going to discuss right now. So we completed familiarizing ourselves with vascular imaging to the extent that is required by the clinicians. But more elaborate angiographic studies can be learned from the radiology lectures. But this is what we have to keep in mind for interpreting the results and ordering the required interventions in stroke.
Can open for questions. If anyone has any questions, please ask.
Q&A? What are the questions?
No, not yet.
Okay. We have completed the stroke studies, and next week we'll deal with the next class, we'll deal with the cases mostly. And those will be interesting cases, which will be challenging to guess what you're going to do. And depending on the imaging and the vascular imaging as well as the clinical profile, what modality of treatment, and
so one question has come, which is better for cerebral AV malformations?
Cerebral AV malformations, is the intervention planned is DSA. But DSA. For the screening you can do MR angiography, but for treatment and it is DSA. So we are there is a lot of request for a repeat class of clinical stroke syndromes and brainstem syndrome, and we have planned for next week.
Next week, Monday and Friday.
So those people, I think we had some 80 people have attended that, but there are now we have more requests coming for repetition of those classes. So plan to do it next week, Monday and Friday.
Yes.
And we'll have some cases also, so that others are also interested in attending the course. We
yeah. One more question: what are recommendations for intracranial stenting?
The intracranial stenting is evidence. The Sampras trial is a negative trial, and it is not recommended.
Mm-hmm.
But the case to case basis, when there is no other option, people are doing, and in fact, in Pune also, Dr. Ananda Lurkar favors intracranial stenting in certain cases, like Vikram Hurade also that. But there are some indications, but Sampras trial has shown that intracranial stenting is best treated with aggressive medical management than the stenting.
Someone has raised their hand, someone called Shat, and can you ask your question? And so we are going to repeat the clinical syndrome classes for stroke, and they will be held next week. That means on 4th and 8th of May. 4th and 8th of May, we will be repeating the classes of stroke. And one more question regarding carotid burden score.
Mm.
Has any trial used it?
Carotid burden score is not yet used in many trials, but there are some case series and case reports. In fact, my research team, Dr. Kriti Shri and Srinivas Rao, and they are working on development of a software for assessing the clot burden score along with the collaterals. So it's ongoing study, but it is there. There are studies, but not convincing. Not convincing in the sense that we cannot say that the RCTs are there or anything. But this is a knowledge that is evolving, and we should slowly acquire more familiarity with clot burden score and interpretation. So it's an important tool. No doubt it's an important tool. So we are doing a lot of research on that.
And now more questions are coming up. How to diagnose ICAD, ICAD?
Intracranial?
ICAD, intracranial.
Internal carotid artery disease.
Yeah.
So that is, the ICAD disease is whenever you suspect large vessel occlusions, clinically, you have to do a Doppler screening.
Mm-hmm.
And if it is extra cranial carotid, you have to do Doppler screening. And if it is intracranial, you do MR angiography, that will tell you whether there is any stenosis. And if you think there is an acute stroke, and you can plan endovascular therapy immediately.
Yes.
Within now up to 24 hours,
mm-hmm.
depending on the mismatch.
Yes.
Mismatch.
Now, many questions have started. Should carotid stenting be done for asymptomatic carotid stenosis?
Asymptomatic carotid stenosis is a big controversial topic, but carotid stenting, now there is the recommendation now is that it should be resorted to when the patients are poor surgical risks, where they have got multiple comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, poor surgical risks, carotid stenting is done. But based on that CREST trial, this was the recommendation. But then the population that is included in CREST trial was again studied, and they have done a trial called Weaver trial. That has shown that the complication rate of stenting has been brought down to 1.5% from 5% earlier. So now I think more studies will come recommending this procedure in asymptomatic individuals also.
If we have a tandem lesion and acute stroke with M1 occlusion, should we go for thrombectomy?
That depends on the person who is doing that. So we'll not be able to answer.
Person
we can only
specific, yeah.
Person specific, and if they want to tackle, they will tackle, and it is up to them. The
yeah.
expertise.
Yeah. How to differentiate acute and chronic occlusions? And one more similar. What is the meaning of floating thrombus on CTA, which radiologists keep saying?
floating thrombus is floating thrombus. If they have two images and it is differently seen,
yeah,
they can say that it is a floating thrombus.
Floating thrombus.
And the other question which you said?
Acute and chronic occlusions.
Acute and chronic occlusions, it depends on the, again, perfusion imaging only. CT perfusion imaging. Depending on that clinical profile, you have to suspect. And if it is clinical profile is fitting with our CT or mismatches, well, we have considered so many mismatches.
Yes,
diffusion weighted on flare mismatch, diffusion and T2 mismatch, diffusion and ADC mismatch, and clinical and MRI mismatch. So there are so many things. So that we have to base on that only.
Yes, sir. So in carotid stenosis, sometimes with the echogenicity, we can tell whether that thrombus is occluded.
Yes, that is the arterial wall and the thrombus imaging. Echogenicity is that.
Yes,
that also can tell.
Okay. Then what are the guidelines for doing carotid stenting endarterectomy for symptomatic carotid stenosis? Is there any percentage of stenosis which is to be considered?
The 70% and above, yes, symptomatic stenosis is to be dealt with, and even 69% also can be subjected to carotid endarterectomy. But stenting as on today is reserved for people who have got comorbidities, because stenting is giving rise to more strokes, whereas carotid endarterectomy is associated with thrombus. Complications and MI. But these two come mostly by CREST study, and that is recommended that only in those cases.
Yes. So then if there are no more questions, then we can conclude for the day, and the next session we will be putting the notice on the WhatsApp groups.
And mostly it will be a cases with the clinical case syndromes, clinical stroke syndromes, both will deal. We'll have one or two cases and the talk on clinical.
Okay. Now, here one more question has come on YouTube Live. How do we tackle non-corresponding ICS stenosis?
With a symptomatic one to be dealt or not dealt, symptomatic one is...
That non-corresponding will be treated as an asymptomatic. Yes. By mistake sent to... Okay. No problem. Thank you so much. Thank you all for attending. Please share with your friends who will be interested in attending these neurological lecture series, and we will be continuing even after lockdown. If you want to specify any timing changes, please let us know, but we are as of now continuing with Monday and Friday 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. Thank you so much.